Hello, welcome back. There are many technology developments that enable the creation of open government. The vision is that anybody can pose a question and that the correct and precise answer is given in real time, without needing any manual steps. Or even better, the answer is given without having to ask a question. Without using any technology, finding usable data is like searching for the needle in the haystack. So, how can technologies be used for creating open government? This question will be answered in this lecture, which provides an overview of some of the basic technologies. This is the first piece of the puzzle to help you to analyze the characteristics of a particular open government case. We are focusing on the main characteristics of the most important technologies that contribute to the creation of open government. We take an ideal view as practice is more stubborn. Much of the effort for open government is concentrated around the opening of data or the creation of compelling content. But let's first consider what the user wants. The user has a certain challenge or problem or is aware of a need and wants to solve that. For example, how much public money is spent on ensuring the safety in their neighborhood? Ideally, a question is being asked and the answer is given. Unfortunately, this is currently not reality. Most of the time, we start by searching the internet. That's the first technology we address. Next, there's a need to access data. APIs are discussed, which provide us with an interface to access data. After that, the data needs to be visualized and presented. Through APIs, different sources of content can be integrated in a visual interface called a mashup. Mashups are often used for opening data, for instance, to show how much money is spent by a government. But the role of technology does not stop there. Ideally, machines are able to understand data, which requires the adding of semantics that can be processed by machines. This means that chunks of data should be related to each other, which can be done by linking data. Once data can be understood and linked, we can use computational search engines. Users can ask a question and the technology provides the answer. Machines do the hard work instead of human beings. How would you start looking for an open government website or data sets? Most of the people do not begin by going to an organization's webpage. This is usually because they are unaware of the most appropriate place to find the data. Instead, many people start by using a search engine, such as Google. Search engines have indexed the web and show results based on search queries. As such, it's important to enable the indexing of websites and ensure that the data of websites are described using the right wording. Choosing the right wording requires an understanding of how users search for your website. Only then are users able to find the right website. Recall and precision are important criteria when a machine is searching the internet for data. Recall is about how well a search engine finds what you want. A high level of recall results in a large set of answers that is relevant for a specific inquiry. Precision is about how well a system weeds out what you don't want. High precision results in a small set of relevant answers for your question. A high recall means that most of the relevant results are shown. We often employ keyword-based searching, which has a high level of recall and a low level of precision and shows many relevant results. In contrast, natural language search engines have a higher precision rate and a lower level of recall. They provide the right possible answers. Website designers should be aware of this to enable search engines to index the website and let users to easily find their website. There's a lot of content available. Data as content can take on forms like text, images, video or audio and are often designed for people to consume directly through reading, watching and listening. However, machines cannot make any sense out of this kind of data. That's where tagging comes in. By using tags, you can describe what the text is about. This is called metadata. Data describes data. This data can be used by machines, for example, for facilitating the search of certain data. Tagging is what you do on Facebook when you're adding the names of your friends in a picture. If millions of people do this, it becomes possible for machines to use these tags. Automatic tagging is also possible. For example, face recognition search engine can identify people and add tags, which reduces processing time. Tagging data is often rewarded with better visibility in search results and make it easier for others to find what they are looking for. Data needs to be made accessible using interfaces. API is an abbreviation for Application Programming Interface and is a way for programmers to use a certain application using a standardized interface. For example, OpenEdX includes a suite of APIs that allow you to build applications that interact with the edX platform. APIs are provided by major web players such as Google, Amazon, Facebook, and Twitter to enable others to use their data and functionality. Through APIs, you have access to data or functionality that you can integrate in your own applications. You can think of an API as a kind of interface to building blocks. By using building blocks, APIs makes it easier to release data and build your own applications. When APIs change, this affects many people and companies, and software might stop working. Therefore, always ensure that previous version of an API keeps on running. By using APIs, you can use data in real time, which means that the most recent data is used. APIs can result in accelerated use of data and functionality by others. Now, how we know how to access the data? There is a need to create a visual interface. Without any doubt, you have used a mashup in the past. A mashup refers to the integration of various sources of data in a single user interface. Ajax, with research to a combination of asynchronous JavaScript and extensible markup language, XML, is used most often. JavaScript is a simple scripting language, whereas XML is used to describe the interfaces. There are numerous other protocols which are related. These technologies enable the creation of a new application quickly by using visual wiring and mapping the interfaces of APIs. Mashups can be created using visual editors, and basic programming skills are only occasionally needed. Often, a geographic map is used as the basis for creating a mashup. A typical example of cartographic data is the use of Google Maps to mass location information and, for example, pollution data. A geographic map on which data is mapped is often used. Applications such as Fix My Street are typical examples of mashups. In Fix My Street, citizens interact with local governments. Citizens can report damages in their neighborhood. Through this platform, it's easier for the municipalities to quickly respond and fix damages. Technologies play an enabling function for open government. The problem with describing data and data APIs is that each person might make them differently, resulting in heterogeneous descriptions. There's no standard description that everybody understands, nor a standard way in which communication system interpret the information. Semantics provide meaning and are necessary to refer what data denotes. For example, being open can refer to being outside, the attitude of a person, a door being open, and so on. Having money to burn should not be interpreted as that somebody makes a fire using bills. The semantic web is based on describing the meaning of data in a structured manner. Most of the protocols use tags to describe the meaning. In this way, both humans and machines can understand the meaning. there's a wide range of technologies and protocols addressing semantics. Once data is available in a structured format, how do you know if data is related to each other? Linked data refers to connecting chunks of data to one another. For example, John has an email address and the name John can be linked to that email address. The resource description framework, RDF, forms one of the basic building blocks for describing how data is related. By providing links in RDF, applications may exploit the extra knowledge from other datasets. By linking John's name to an email address, an application can infer what John's email address is without needing any human intervention. Linking all kinds of data to each other creates what we call the semantic web, consisting of numerous links and enabling machines to infer. All those technologies together have the potential to create a real open government. Instead of having to do the work manually, a question can be asked and automatically the answer can be generated. Wolfram Alpha is an example of such a computational search engine that employs natural language processing and a semantic web to provide an answer to the questions asked. This enables users to search with high precision as the meaning of data is described and the datasets are related to each other. Try it! Using these technologies, it's possible to find the needle in the haystack. Human beings ask a question and the technology provides the answers. Machines do the hard work to find the needle. But it's not that easy, as you have seen. Only a brief introduction of the underlying technologies has been given. Furthermore, semantic descriptions of the data are necessary to enable machines to reason about data. Thank you for your attention.